Hi, everybody. Welcome to Sama, Seattle Sacred Music. We are in Seattle. I hope you're doing well. I'm Derek Mazzoni, your host. I have a great guest today on Sama. I was going to say tonight because I do a nighttime show on radio, but it's today. It's whenever it is. This is one of the few artists I've welcomed back to Sama. He is a friend. He's a singer, activist, trumpet player. His name is Sonny Singh. He's got a brilliant new record called Chardi Kala that I love. We've been playing it quite a bit on KEXP. And he's going to be on tour. Thank goodness we're doing tours again. And he's doing really wonderful work. And I wanted to have a bit of a conversation with him because last time we spoke, things were different. You remember those times when things were different? They really were. And things are a little different right now. They're not exactly back to normal because there is no going back. But I'm curious to find out where things are going, and especially with Sonny, what he's learned and what he could offer to other artists, other immigrants, and other human beings in the world. He's been doing a bit of touring. He, as I said before, he has sent us some great concert footage from Joe's Pub and other places that I like quite a bit. We're going to watch that, and then we're going to have a little conversation with Sonny Singh on Sama. Enjoy.
ਚੈਨ ਨਾ ਆਵੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇੱਕ ਪਲ ਚੈਨ ਨਾ ਆਵੇ ਸਜਣਾ ਤੇਰੇ ਬਿਨਾ ਸਜਣਾ ਤੇਰੇ ਬਿਨਾ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇੱਕ ਪਲ ਚੈਨ ਨਾ ਆਵੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇੱਕ ਪਲ ਚੈਨ ਨਾ ਆਵੇ ਸਜਣਾ ਤੇਰੇ ਬਿਨਾ ਸਜਣਾ ਤੇਰੇ ਬਿਨਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਕਲੀਆ ਜੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਲੱਗਣਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਕਲੀਆ ਜੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਲੱਗਣਾ ਸਜਣਾ ਤੇਰੇ ਬਿਨਾ ਸਜਣਾ ਤੇਰੇ ਬਿਨਾ
Sonny Singh, welcome to Sama.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for being here. Thanks for coming back.
It's a joy to be back. Yeah, I always love talking with you.
Thank you. I want to get you into KXP. I want to get a new studio with you. Probably Gabriel's going to go like, no. I want to do this one. It's like, okay.
Well, Gabriel's got time of day working against him because I'd have to wake up really early for his show.
I know. It's like, okay.
But it would be worth it. I would do it.
It'd be worth it. No, I think I'd love to see a banter between between you and Gabriel. You've got great history.
Yeah, and we play together as well.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, okay, let's see. How could that work? Maybe he could come in. I mean, I know we're now, we had Moby on. Everybody came in and sang along. So maybe that could happen. It's an idea.
Would love that.
It's an idea. But let's talk about your life. Let's talk about the time period since we've last had you on. What's been going on? You know, you released a record, but don't talk to me as a musician. Talk to me as a human being. What's been going on with you?
I feel like it's been a little, a year and some change since we last spoke on Sama. And I mean, time is just really confusing these days. But, you know, from a musical perspective, which obviously is from a heart perspective for me too, because music is a reflection of my heart and soul, at least when I'm at my best. And I would say the biggest thing is that I'm playing my new music live. So finally, starting early last summer, actually, I just noticed that I got a Facebook memory. One of the few good things Facebook is good for these days are those memories that pop up. That just a few days ago is the 1 year anniversary of my first show of the sort of Chardi Kala band playing this new music of mine live in New York City. And so that's just been such a such an incredible process to see what it's like for this music that I spent a couple of years on in the studio, really making a studio album, you know, everything recorded separately, people, you know, recording from all over the country and all over the world in some places. So for that to come to life in real time with a band has just been really exciting. I've been doing Red Baraat for so long, like I've kind of forgot what it feels like to feel really nervous before a gig. Because with Red Baraat, it's just like, there's so much comfort there, right? Like I've been in that role as a trumpet and singer in Red Baraat for over a decade. And so like these shows still, it's a year later and still I get these nerves before going on stage with this project. And I think it's a really healthy thing. I surpassed 40 years old during the pandemic or right before the pandemic, and it's a good moment to be feeling like, oh, I'm just scratching the surface of something new here, something that's like always been in me but has kind of been on the periphery, and so I feel like it's an exciting period of growth. I love playing this music live. I love interacting with musicians in real time. I love the improvisation and the stretching out that we do live that isn't really reflected on the album, and really developing a vibe with a fairly consistent band. I'm grateful to be working with a lot of really talented musicians that are bringing their own musical voice to this. Some of them are on the record, some of them aren't, but they're all super invested and just bringing a lot of life to it.
That's great. I remember talking with you about missing performing live, because mm-hmm. when last we spoke, that wasn't happening.
No.
And, you know, you miss it, and then you try to remember it, and then when you're actually doing it, what was the difference between you actually performing for the first time in an audience and what you were expecting to what the reality was after COVID? Or I shouldn't say after COVID. We're still in it during COVID.
You know, I'm not exactly sure. So from a Red Baraat perspective, I can speak in a more sort of, I can speak to that question a little bit better because there was a long-standing pre-pandemic history of playing live with that band specifically. And the first time we played together as a band was actually in Fort Greene Park. Like instead of doing a rehearsal in a studio when, you know, the stakes were kind of high, you know, last spring, or early last summer, we just decided to get together in Fort Greene Park and do like a little bit of busking, rehearsing, and just playing with musicians in real time like that again. Like I felt like that part of the experience. So audience like didn't even matter in that moment, because we were playing in a park. It was fairly unannounced. Like just that like real time interaction with music, that's just been a part of me for so long, right? I've been in that band since the beginning, since 2008. It was like a flood of emotions, just like getting to interact with musicians in that way again. And so I think that's something that I often took for granted, right? Like when you've been in a band for a long time, you think more about, oh, the audience was really great at this show. Like I really felt their energy. But to remember that so much of what we do is about that relationship and communication between band members, between bandmates. So that's been a really big change. And then with my new project, with my solo project, it's just everything has been new about it. And so, you know, after making a studio record, it's like, what is this going to look like and feel like? There's so much instrumentation on the record. So how can I boil this down to a 5-piece band? And what are people going to think, right? Like I had no idea what an audience was going to think. And hearing from folks after shows, even really small shows that I've been doing, just the way people are moved and what they're taking away from it is just kind of like, wow, my intention really seems to be coming across here. And obviously my bandmates seem to be getting that intention too, because they're bringing it to their artistry in the music. So it's all been super positive and super, super moving.
Awesome. Awesome. So let's watch some music. You were gracious enough to send that. And so we're talking about it. Might as well share it. Here it is. Sonny Singh. The new record is Chardi Kala. It's out right now on all streaming platforms, and it's available. Check it out.
All right. Let's do this.
Chardi Kala,
interesting. Thank you for that. You're an activist also. It's been a challenging few years. You're presenting music that is hopeful, but in videos, you know, we love your videos. Your videos and your songs, you have a message. You know, it's not just about love. It's a complicated message, I would say, because you're tapping into your heritage, you're tapping into an ancient history, and you're transmutating it into a modality for the 21st century. I don't want to be academic about it, but I'm curious, is like an artist such as yourself that has that legacy, that is putting that legacy foremost, like from the title of your song to the way you're putting your videos together, your intention. What are you trying to say to the to your audience right now, knowing that, you know, you've taken a, you don't have a, you know, you're not putting a hood over your eyes. You're seeing what's going on in the world, and you're speaking to that. How is your music playing into that? I know it's a big question, but this is what you're putting out, so I'm curious.
Yeah, thanks for that. Really thoughtful framing. I mean, first and foremost, I think from an artistic perspective, I'm simply trying to cope and ground myself in these very trying times. The music, most of the music on the record is original music that I started putting together in a time when I was feeling a lot of despair, late 2018, early 2019. So we're in the midst of the Trump administration. We have people like Bolsonaro coming to power, people like Duterte still in power, right? Just Netanyahu and Israel, just like this global wave of authoritarianism and fascism, Modi in India, right? And you know, we could go on and on. The list, unfortunately, is not a short one. We have these acts of white supremacist terror and anti-Semitic terror and Islamophobic terror happening in the United States. And I found myself sort of gravitating back to Sikh kirtan, which is devotional music, which was my first musical outlet as a child. And I'm sure we talked about it last time. And so the music was kind of written and born out of just like, you know, music is very much, I think for most musicians, it is like very much a part of our own healing and grounding process, right? And so that's what was going on for me. And then, you know, it just made sense for me to share it as I was kind of coming up with ideas and revisiting some of these hundreds of year old devotional poems, mostly Sikh devotional poems, but also some Sufi poetry that I was drawing from. And then when it started fomenting into an idea of making a record, I just kept gravitating back to this idea of Chardi Kala because I was feeling so much despair. And Chardi Kala is an idea and a practice in the Sikh community of eternal optimism, ever rising spirits in the darkest of times, right? My people and many of our people have seen very dark times, right? I mean, we all have, but coming from a community that's faced a lot of oppression and suffering, there's this idea that no matter what, we have this obligation to ourselves, to each other, to the divine, to remain in high spirits. And I'd never like totally reflected on that idea as a musician. It's something that I hold very near and dear to me. It's something that I've seen embodied in my community so much historically and presently, this like living in high spirits vibe. But as a musician, like when I thought about it, I was like, wait, this is kind of the point of art for me. It's not to like erase the bad stuff or ignore or separate us from pain or distract us from the brutal realities of the world. Not at all. But it's out of that we see the light, right? Like we know that that if we lead with love, if we lead with those who are most impacted by issues, right, in the way that a community organizer might do, and if we really center that devotion and unity, that we can only be in high spirits. And so in many ways, I made this record to practice Chardi Kala myself as an individual, and hopefully for that to sort of emanate outwards, because I think we all need that reminder and need things that that help us stay grounded and in high spirits. And, you know, I wrote the record before the pandemic popped off. And then, of course, the pandemic hits as I'm finishing the record, and it felt all the more important. And so, you know, just to talk a little bit more about your question, because it's not just about like, oh, we stay joyful no matter what, but that's actually a very, at its best, that's a very revolutionary principle, right? Like if for those of us who believe in a world that could be very different, a world that could be much more equitable, right? A world that is anti-racist, anti-sexist, a world that is socially and economically just, we have to believe we can change things, right? We have to believe, and we have to believe that our greatest enemies can change too, right? And we have to see that humanity and that divinity that is in all living things. And so that's a practice of Chardi Kala. That's a practice of living in high spirits. And so I hope my music gets that across in what it sounds like, even if folks don't understand the words, many of which were written hundreds of years ago, as I said. And I hope that folks also feel some urgency in the sounds that I'm making, right? Like I also hope that it's a wake-up call to folks who aren't really activated, right? Aren't really paying as much attention as maybe they should. So in some of my music videos, for example, I've tried to draw attention to some political issues happening in India and elsewhere right now.
I love how you're describing the intention behind the record, about staying hopeful, about staying optimistic, not in a context of like, nothing's happening, we're all joyful here, because specifically you come from a culture, and you spoke to this a little while ago. It wasn't like, you know, here's a bad time, oh, it's all being good right now. It's like, no, here's a bad time, another bad time, another bad time. And we have to get through this because it doesn't work, you know, it's not one or the other. Sometimes you have a period of bad times. We had the last administration, then we get the pandemic. Throughout this whole thing, we've got climate change. Like we're in living, this is now June. Half the country's got crazy temperature, you know, deadly temperatures that are going on, but people are complaining about gas prices. I'm not saying the gas prices aren't something, you know, this is your income, but it's like, it's so easy for us to see where the powers that be can suddenly turn people against each other. You're seeing this right now, where different immigrant communities are looking at each other suspect. You're looking at the duality between red and blue in the United States. You're seeing power work its way through all of the countries you spoke of. You're seeing a sense of nationalism that's coming up right now, where it's like me, my country, my people are the best. That's not going to help us as we're dealing with these existential crises, one after another, to survive as a species. And it kind of is important for artists such as yourself to present an art form, music, this one, and video, that give people a sense of hope. And that's a kind of like, that's a very fragile, but yet a very powerful thing, that sense of hope that they can get past this. So just because the powers that be are telling you that, no, it's not us, we're the problem, those other people that don't look like you, they're the problem.
Yeah.
that's not a way, you can't lecture somebody out of that mindset, but you can present a art form that makes your body and your mind change about that person. I find that's the only thing that kind of works because, you know, I think I alluded to this before, like my parents' generation, they don't understand the world that we're living in right now. Things have changed so much. And I'm trying to constantly tell them, it's like, these Haitian and Portuguese immigrants are just the same as the Polish immigrants that we were when we got here. You know, they're trying to live their lives. They're not a threat. They're just trying to feed their children and live their lives also. You have to find a way to open up your heart and accept this. Mm-hmm. I could say that, but if I play music from those cultures, then they look at it differently. I'm not saying it's in and out, but it's like they look at it differently. So I love the fact that you spoke to that so eloquently. And it's kind of your job right now. And I hate to just like put it on you, but it is kind of your job to kind of help that and put that out. Because we're not, most people don't get any Sikh music. They don't know anything about it. I was like, those are interesting people in turbans that are walking around. And you know, they're curious, but they're not that curious. It's like they're going to go up and ask you a question.
Yeah.
But if they like your music and they hear about these stories, that's a big win. That's big, Sonny. That's like, okay, maybe we can get out of this crazy mess and make that work. So good job.
Yeah. No, I appreciate that. And I mean, I think you articulated essentially why I'm a musician, you know? And again, as I was saying, it kind of started with self-survival, right? Self-preservation, coping with all of this. And then eventually as I grew older, you know, it became also like a strategic mandate of like why we make art, right? And that collective need, I think it's so critical.
I mean, you also, you could have gone into so many different directions. So a personal story a little bit. It's just like when, and it could be similar. It's like when I came to the United States, I was in Dorchester in Boston. I think I might have told this before, but it bears repeating. And I came into a place where I came from Poland. Everybody was Polish. Yeah. You know, it was just communist Poland. And suddenly I'm in America, not speaking the language, in Dorchester, which is a really interesting neighborhood, with all these different populations, Irish, Italian, Portuguese. They didn't like each other. And obviously Poland had, I lived across the street from an African-American family. And it was my first time, you know, becoming friends. My first friend was a kid named Tony, African-American kid. And we were awesome. But it was really like, you know, it was interesting because suddenly the white kids in the neighborhood were like, what are you doing? In my understanding of that broken English, picking up the language, seeing what was going on. Boston is a crazy racist city at that time.
Yeah.
And suddenly these people that I thought were intriguing, because I came from a place where everybody spoke one language, everybody was the same, to have this diversity. And I was like, this is phenomenal. I was hearing music. I was hearing all these things. I then suddenly realized that these people don't like each other. There's a battle going on, and it's a battle for crumbs. It's not a battle for power. It's literally whatever it's going to give you. You were in North Carolina. You and your brother were the only Sikh kids. I'm a white male. You know, it's like I had an accent, but everybody else kind of like, okay, whatever, you know, you're Polish. I'm going to say a bunch of really mean, hurtful things about your culture and your heritage, but it's different than being with a turban and all that in North Carolina, in the South. You didn't, you know, I'm not, your narrative is probably very complicated, but you didn't crumble under that pressure. You actually transmutated that into something really beautiful and powerful. And a lot of people don't get that. A lot of people that were born here don't really, you know, it's not a reality that they can understand. And I try to get people, you know, that have gone through that to speak to that, because it connects people in that sense of humanity. And especially you're 40, so, you know, 20 years ago was a different country. It was a different kind of place, you know. And 25 years ago, when you were a teenager in North Carolina, I don't know what kind of hell you went through, but you survived and you actually created a beautiful artwork out of it. So if you could speak to that a little bit, you know, in that way where it's like, you know, you don't have to share things that might trigger you or somebody else, but it's like, I know it must have not have been like, you know, oh, I was just loved by everybody, and they celebrated every time I walked in the door.
Yes, that would be a correct read of the situation. Yeah, I mean, my childhood, I was actually born in Charlotte, North Carolina. My parents immigrated in the late 60s and early 70s and settled in Charlotte. And at that time, the South Asian community there was really small. It was mostly a white and black city. And I went to school with a mix of white and black kids, and you know, kids on the playground would ask me, "Are you white or black?" That was literally the question they'd ask me. You know, kids are like very, very frank and forthright. They're often more comfortable talking explicitly about race than adults are, in a way that can be positive, right? But obviously, that binary framing was very, very confusing to me as a 5-year-old, or however old I was when I was in kindergarten, first grade, and the bubble of leaving my family, leaving my family's bubble, yeah, was like kind of a shock to the system, right? I never knew exactly how to answer that question, but what was clear to me, even from kindergarten, I was 4 or 5, was that I wanted to be white, right? That being white would be better for me, right? Like you don't have to have studied, the social construction of race and, you know, racial politics in the United States to know that, right? You know that from when you were a toddler, you can just see it, right? And I saw it on the playground. I saw it based on the economic realities of the white kids versus a lot of the black kids at my school. I saw it based on who the popular kids were and who were less popular, who were more made fun of, right? And so I knew that I wanted to be white. And that's such a painful thing to even say out loud, but that's the reality, right? I think as soon as I kind of entered that environment, I didn't feel any sense of pride in who I was in my Sikh background or my brown skin or my Punjabi South Asian heritage. I felt a lot of shame and I felt a lot of confusion. And my parents who migrated here did their best, right? They weren't opening up conversations about these issues with me because they didn't really know what was going on themselves. You know, we still haven't talked that explicitly about those days because, like, they don't even like to talk. My dad came here in 1969 as a graduate student at the University of Minnesota, and he's never really told me about the racism he experienced. I can only imagine, as a turban-wearing Sikh man moving to Minnesota in 1969, what he dealt with. But anyway, I didn't have a lot of ways to cope or process what I was experiencing. I had an older brother who's going through all the same stuff, but we also never talked about it, right? This was an unfortunate reality where that kind of communication wasn't really happening in my family. And so it would have been really, really easy for me to crumble, as you say. And I think I did in many ways. Like, I was a very insecure kid. I didn't have a whole lot of self-confidence. I certainly made some friends here and there, but it was tough. It was very tough because that harassment, bullying, you know, my turban was pulled off on the playground, when I was 8 or 9 years old. Those sorts of like humiliating acts of othering, of marginalization, of bigotry really, really scarred my, childhood, or, you know, impacted my childhood pretty directly. I would say, music is one of the things that saved me, in terms of like having an outlet to start sort of channel what I was going through. I started playing the trumpet at 9 years old, and by the time I got to high school, it became a really important part of my sort of voice and my processing of the world. And also another thing that happened in high school was I went to this camp. It was called Anytown USA. Sounds really corny, but there was a part of this national organization called the National Conference for Community and Justice that ran these camps that were essentially sort of social justice camps for teenagers, where they brought together teenagers from like every walk of life, right? There were like literally active, Chicano gang members. This was I was in Arizona by this time, Phoenix, Arizona, another really tough place to grow up as a turban wearing Sikh kid.
It didn't get better, just got.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, we had kids that were experiencing gang violence firsthand. We had white kids from the suburbs. We had people like me. We had, you know, it was just like quite a cross section, going through this experience of facilitated, honest discussion about our lives. And that was really the first time where I was telling my own story to my peers. And I was like feeling heard. and then connecting to what they were going through, like connecting to like hearing what the, what, you know, the white gay kid was experiencing in terms of homophobia and being like, wait, that feels, you know, that was like not as, as someone who's generally identified as straight throughout my life, that wasn't an issue as a teenager that I'd really identified with or thought about much. And then I was like, wait, there's a connection here, right? Or hearing about being sexually harassed by a woman, right? Or hearing about the racism that my Black or Chicano, peers were experiencing, and seeing that there's a common thread here, and that in that space we all came together to share our stories. And I left that, I was 16 when I was at that experience, and I left that experience being like, this is my life's work. Like continuing this conversation, continuing this work is what my life is about. And, you know, I don't, how long ago was that? A long time ago. Oh, 35 years later, it continues to be my life's work. So I started facilitating workshops and facilitating this work after that as a teenager. And that's the work that I still do in addition to my music. And through this new musical project, I'm trying to bring those things together on stage a little bit and really incorporate that sort of political, historical education and history kind of within the music.
Perfect. Thank you. It's awesome. It's a perfect time for this right now because, you know, this was 35 years ago. So obviously it's a completely different world, but it was like an incubation because
I just made myself 50, 25 years ago,
25 years ago. That was like an incubation for where we are right now. And sometimes these things, you know, they're too ahead of their time. Or another word for it, they just can't be received. They're not exactly to it at the time. There's just like, there's a population doesn't really quite understand this right now. And now they can, and they are. And going back to my initial point, you're doing this through an art form. So it's not a lecture. It's not, you know, you're not trying to make people feel bad for the choices that they made before or because they didn't understand. It's like, here is this new understanding. Here is this new offering. And it kind of goes back to, you know, to Sama's motto is like celebrate diversity, but champion our shared humanity. And it is so important for that, for my kids, for your future kids, and for anybody, everybody else out there. This is the work that needs to be seen and heard right now, not just in a context of like, okay, we're going to accept our friends who look different than us or may speak a different language or choose to wear different clothes, but as in like, we've got some serious shit that's coming up. Look at the thermostat wherever you are right now. It's not going down. It's going up realistically and metaphorically, and we need to come together in order to make that possible. Indeed. Sonny, thank you so much. We're going to hear some more music. So let's get into the nitty-gritty. The record's out touring. Can we see you on the West Coast? I mean, obviously, it's easy for you to just like, text, I'm available, and play Abaddon East Coast. But what about the other part of the United States?
I am so ready and really hoping to line up some national touring and beyond. So anyone hearing this who is interested in bringing this music to your venue or performing arts center, college, and university, we're road ready and getting out there on the East Coast already, and really hope to come out west. Okay. Definitely hope to do that KEXP live session when we're out west too. So there may be an LA show coming up this summer, awaiting some details. I recorded much of the album in LA, so that's been a high priority to make happen. But we shall see what the coming months bring.
Yeah. And also, it's a different world. And as I alluded before, I took a month long road trip last summer, to show my children who were born here what this country is like. And that it's not, you know, they live in Seattle. So their idea of the Midwest and everything is like Nazis, racists, homophobes, etc. They're there. But it wasn't like that. We went all over the place, and we found these, we called them blueberries in the red soup of this country. And I would love to see you play in North Carolina. I would love to see you play in Phoenix. I would love to see you play in Rapid City, Oklahoma City, all these places that you kind of need your work more than LA and New York and Seattle.
Sure.
'Cause, you know, I'm not saying we get it. Obviously, there's a lot that don't. But it would be great. You know, I was telling this to a friend of ours, who's out of Tehran and wants to tour the United States. I'm like, get a van. You know, I'm not saying it's going to be easy, but go play in these places because they need you more than the coastal elites, shall we say. So I hope that happens. I hope that's possible because it would make a really fabulous movie and a really fabulous story to see you play out there because they're ready too. You know, they're so grateful when you come. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. And I've definitely had that experience touring the country and the world with Red Baraat, right? Sometimes it's in those most unsuspecting places where you have the most magical shows where folks aren't too cool or jaded as a Brooklyn audience can sometimes be or an LA audience can sometimes be or they're just like...
Exactly. It's like...
So I've seen bits and pieces with through that experience and would love to get out there with this band as well.
Okay, perfect. Sonny, best of luck. Thank you one and all. This is Sama, Seattle Sacred Music and Art. We're on every week. Please like, subscribe, share so we can share more of these amazing stories of artists throughout the world. However you may be receiving us, TikTok, Instagram, Twitch, all the social media platforms. Please tell our stories. Go buy this record. Actually buy it. And because it's tough to bubble up in streaming services. And tell your friends. And let's try to make the world a better place. Bye.
It seems like some kind of utopian vision to imagine a world without all these forms of oppression and exploitation. Right? To dream that, to imagine it is quite difficult. And that's part of why I'm a musician, because I think through art, through music, we can help at least imagine it. And Antonio Machado's words, "Se hace camino al andar," just speak deeply to me that we'll figure it out as we go, right? If we lead with love, if we lead with unity, if we lead with connectedness, we're going to figure this out.
cambiar, si no hace camino para andar.